Well, good morning, everyone. It is so wonderful to see all of you here today. And to be honest, when we conjured up the idea, of having a conference on evaluation, to be honest, we weren't sure if anyone would actually show up. I've been in the evaluation field long enough to know that just the word evaluation, in quotes, can cause many different kinds of emotions, from axes to guns to hangman's nooses to check boxes to light bulbs to microscopes and so on. So you can imagine our excitement in seeing how much the topic of next generation evaluation has created. But to get started, we want to ask you a question to see how you're feeling about these topics today. So in some very small groups, because you're close together, so two or three, we're going to ask you which of the following four adjectives describes how you're feeling about the conference topics, developmental evaluation, shared measurement, and big data. Are you skeptical? Are you scared? Are you curious? Or are you excited? And maybe all of those. And then introduce yourself at your table or with the small group that you're sitting next to and why you chose the word. So we have markers and some post-its that you can use throughout the day. But take a post-it and write down the word that reflects how you're feeling about the topics today and being here. And then for about 4 or 5 minutes, introduce yourself and talk about your adjective. Okay, everyone, gonna ask you to wrap up your conversation. I'm gonna ask you, did you meet some new people? Yes, new people? All right, a quick show of hands. We're gonna do a little assessment here. A quick show of hands. How many of you chose the word excited? Just raise your hand, excited. Okay, thank you. How many of you chose curious? You're voting more than once, right? Okay, that's okay. This is not a rigorous evaluation. How many of you are scared? You should be. Okay, and what about skeptical? Good, thank you. Well, fun, okay. So, I cheated. I chose a different word. I chose the question why, the word why. And that's because it's been the word that's defined my entire career. When I was young, I loved reading Nancy Drew books. Anybody remember Nancy Drew? I don't want to say how old that makes us, but okay. I would be the first in line to buy the next book as they came out every few months. When I reflected on why I liked these books so much, I realized it's because they were detective stories, and they were about solving crimes by asking questions, interviewing people, and observing behavior. In other words, collecting evidence. My interest in asking questions continued into my freshman year of college, when I started a business offering to do library research for other students. Though I papered the early signs of dementia, I think. Anyway, though I papered the library with flyers and was an enthusiastic entrepreneur, I ended up having only one taker. My business failed miserably. A few years later, I was a new teacher and found myself continuing to ask questions that were often about the why we were doing things in a certain way. Soon after, my principal told me that my job was not to ask questions, I found myself in a graduate course on curriculum and program evaluation. During the course, I came to understand that there was an emerging profession called evaluation that was grounded in asking important questions, collecting data to answer those questions, and ultimately helping people make more informed decisions that would contribute to a healthier and more just society. Soon thereafter, I decided I would become an evaluator. I've spent the last 30 years thinking about, studying, writing, and teaching about evaluation. Quite simply, I believe that good evaluation practice is a systematic process for collecting and using data to facilitate learning and improvement. As such, it can confirm and affirm what is working and why, and with whom and where. It can provide us with the confidence to make timely and critical decisions. And it can help us communicate our learnings, both internally and with the field. I believe that evaluation has an even greater role to play today than it did even 40 years ago in the Great Society programs in understanding how we can learn our way through some of the complex challenges that are ever present in the social sector. But I also know that evaluation, its theory and its practice, has to evolve. It has to grow and adapt and change just as our approaches to solving social problems must do. To ground what we will be focusing on for the rest of the day, I'd like to share with you three examples of the trends we believe are creating the need for what we've termed next generation evaluation. We think these trends are creating both the opportunity and the need for evaluation practice to live into its future. These trends are increased innovation, different rules of interaction, and the proliferation of digital infrastructure. These trends have emerged as the public and philanthropic sectors have been developing and experimenting with creative approaches to solving social problems. In large part, we believe this is a result of the growing acknowledgement, as John rightly cited earlier, that complex problems require complex solutions. The first of these first example of these trends can be seen in the California Endowment's Building Healthy Communities initiative. The California Endowment is the largest statewide health foundation in the United States. Its particular focus is on providing access to affordable, quality health care for underserved individuals and communities and promoting fundamental improvements in the health status of Californians. The Healthy Communities Initiative is designed as a 10-year, $1 billion investment in 14 communities throughout California. The endowment's leaders believed that in order to transform health statewide, it needed a new approach that addressed the fundamental causes of poverty, distress, and ill health. Thus, it decided to invest heavily in 14 communities to help build the public and political will to take advantage of the policy wins they would pursue at the state level. The Building Healthy Communities Initiative is a complex intervention that uses multiple strategies to engage diverse individuals, groups, and organizations in many ways, it is a social innovation. The BHC work is guided by three core values. There must be synergies between local and statewide efforts so that the initiative will benefit all Californians. Two, there must be a shift in power at the local and state levels so that policies and systems changes can contribute to healthier places. And three, the foundation must be committed to learning along the way so that it can make adjustments and refine its strategy based on new knowledge and information about what's working or not and why. To accomplish the endowment's goals, they are experimenting with several tactics and strategies. For example, their program managers are embedded in each of the 14 communities so they can work better and understand how the endowment can support the local community's work. They're also investing in community organizing to influence policy change at the state level. And they're aligning the state and local work to ensure a broader impact on all California communities, not just the 14 communities that they're investing in. And finally, they're ensuring that all of the 14 communities, each one has a learning and evaluation professional dedicated who lives in the community that provides ongoing information and support to guide the community's progress, and they also provide organization development support. The next example takes us to Grand Rapids, Michigan. Anyone from Michigan? All right, go Grand Rapids. You from Grand Rapids? While many college scholarship programs focus on providing students and financial assistance, there is a tendency to neglect the larger picture of what a young person needs to be college ready. In other words, financial resources, while critically important, are not the only variable that affects a person's interest and ability to not only attend college, but to graduate. Understanding that the issue of college access is multifaceted and complex, the Challenge Scholars Initiative was created. The program is a long-term partnership between the Grand Rapids Community Foundation and the Grand Rapids Public Schools, and it's designed to help students successfully prepare for college. Challenge Scholars is distinctive in that it is providing wraparound supports and improving academic preparation when students are starting in the sixth grade, so that students are ready and eligible for college upon graduation, as well as academically and socio-emotionally ready to persevere and successfully complete college. While there is a strong focus on academic preparation, there are also other innovative strategies that they're using to engage students, parents, and the community more holistically to create a culture of college access and success. For example, schools are developing new partnerships with higher education institutions, which are promoting and supporting professional development opportunities for teachers in K-12, particularly in the critical areas of math and science. School hallways are adopted by universities and branded with university logo colors. Students are meeting with college students and alumni to help create the spirit of college. parent education efforts allow parents to take college courses and experience it for themselves firsthand what it's like to go to college. And there are field trips for students to attend and spend time visiting campuses, which often include overnight stay in dorms. None of these strategies is particularly unique. However, each one has been conceptualized and implemented in a way that recognizes the web of systems and connections that are needed to ensure college readiness and success in the Grand Rapids community. I wanted to share these particular stories with you because I think they're good examples of two of the important trends we are observing in the social sector: increased innovation and the different rules of interaction. In addition to these two trends, we're also noting a third important trend: the proliferation of digital infrastructure. So let's take a look at this little video here and hope it works.
Hi, my name is Jason, and I use a scooter to get around. It's not so easy. I have trouble going to stores, finding bathrooms that are accessible, and meeting up with friends. Of course, I can call ahead, but many places say they're accessible, but really, they're not. There has to be a better way. So I had an idea. What if everyone could share all the accessible places they know? And what if all this was put on one map? And that map was available on the web and mobile phones. I call it Access Map, an online and mobile app where anyone can search for accessible places or review them on their entryways or bathrooms. Access Map opens up a whole new world of choices, and I can instantly find all the accessible places around me, where to eat, shop, grab a coffee, or get a haircut. Even if you're not in a wheelchair, you're invited to give ratings and contribute. Access Map is powered by you. The more you review, the better it gets. For people with canes, walkers, or wheelchairs, even moms and dads with strollers, Access Map is your ticket to mobility freedom. It's easy and free to use. Help make this world a more inclusive one. Join the movement today. Check it out. Accessmap.com.
Great. I think this Access Map that Jason came up with is a good example of the widening, increasingly accessible digital platforms that seem to emerge every day, if not every hour, that are opening up an unprecedented number of opportunities to design and develop a whole host of services and products and information for bettering the lives of many. As we came to understand these trends, we realized that for evaluation to be relevant and useful to the social sector, it meant that evaluation practice would also have to evolve to meet the needs of those implementing social innovations, to those creating different rules of interaction, and the ever-expanding digital infrastructure. We've identified six characteristics that exemplify how leading social sector organizations are thinking about evaluation in the context of these three trends. It's important to note, and this is really important, that what we're suggesting is that these trends or these characteristics are complementary to what we might term traditional evaluation practice. We're not suggesting we throw the baby out with the bathwater, but these are complementary, and you'll see here in a moment, is not just but also. So what are these characteristics? Well, not just a focus on individual programs and projects as we've been in the past, but also a focus on whole systems. Not just a fixed evaluation plan with the typical interim and year-end reports, but also in embracing shorter timelines and cycles and giving real-time feedback using alternative formats. Not just traditional data collection methods, but also using and experimenting with innovative and off, which are often digital data collection methods, but not exclusively digital. Not just one funder, one grantee, one evaluation that has guided much of evaluation practice in the past, but really a movement towards shared responsibility for data collection and learning across multiple organizations. Not just traditional data reporting techniques, but really embracing and using sophisticated data visualization and infographics. And not just evaluator collecting the data, but also everyone collecting and using data as part of ongoing evaluation practice. As we reflected on these trends and characteristics, it became clear that three evaluation approaches have the potential for changing how evaluation can contribute to effective decision-making and action. These are developmental evaluation, shared measurement, and big data. Now, while we are going to have great presentations and case studies on each of these approaches coming up, I just want to share very few high-level thoughts about each of these. Developmental evaluation is a different way of engaging in evaluation practice. Instead of operating against a fixed evaluation plan along with the usual logic model, developmental evaluation offers a much more real-time, learning-oriented, feedback-based, and insight-driven approach to program design and early project implementation. As a result, developmental evaluation is all about being responsive, nimble, and flexible in the planning and implementation of data collection activities. It's about translating data into insights and actionable recommendations quickly. It's about keeping one eye on the program and one eye on the system and a third eye on the intersection between the two. It's about facilitating courageous conversations and providing constructive feedback. And developmental evaluation is definitely about seeing patterns in the data and engaging in a continuous process of sense-making or meaning-making. We've included developmental evaluation as one of the next generation evaluation approaches because A, it's committed to continuous learning, B, because it reflects an understanding of the need for innovations to change, shift, and adapt as they unfold, and three, because it provides just-in-time information that is crucial to knowing whether or not we are on the right path. Sorry about that. As such, we think developmental evaluation reflects at least two of the characteristics that define next-generation evaluation. That is, a focus on whole systems and shorter cycles, more real-time feedback using alternative formats. The second approach we'll be learning more about today is shared measurement. While shared measurement systems do not replace program-level or strategic-level kinds of evaluation activity, they do provide or can provide quantitative and qualitative data on key outcomes and indicators that can help us track our progress and facilitate shared learning and form the basis and foundation of deeper inquiry. I recently came across the results of a survey conducted with 398 nonprofit professional staff. And the good news is that 99% of those surveyed reported collecting data on some kind of metrics, mostly around financial information, marketing, fundraising, and operational activities. The bad news, however, is that fewer than 50% reported tracking any kind of data around outcomes. When asked why they didn't collect data on outcomes, 75% said that they don't have the expertise, the technology, or the time to engage in meaningful monitoring and evaluation activities. So, here we have nonprofits struggling to find their next dollars, trying hard to hang on to quality staff, and passionately trying to provide high levels of service, all without having relevant, credible, and useful information about their effects, influence, or impact. So we have included shared measurement as one of the next generation evaluation approaches because of its potential to bring organizations together to co-determine outcomes and indicators that matter, to share their data and to learn from each other, and ultimately to enhance their organization's ability to meet their goals. Thus, we believe that shared measurement reflects at least two of the characteristics related to next generation evaluation. One, shared responsibility for data collection and learning across multiple organizations. And two, everyone collecting data as part of ongoing evaluation practice. Big data is the third trend. Until recently, big data was not on the radar, was not a hot topic in the evaluation field. At this year's American Evaluation Association conference just a few weeks ago, there were sessions on big data, and it's starting to sprinkle in the conversations in the evaluation field. However, with the publication of the book Big Data earlier this year, and the attention it has received in blogs and newspapers and articles and YouTube videos, we've been intrigued with the question, what role does big data have, if any, in the evaluation field or in evaluation practice? I actually did a Google search of the words big data. And just think to yourself, how many results do you think a Google search, just the words big data, get a number in your head. Ready? 658 million. So to illustrate why big data is the subject of so much attention, let's take a look at this little video.
Yeah.
I don't know whether I thought that was more interesting or I just wanted to dance to the music. I had trouble just standing still. Well, how many of you are scared now that weren't scared before? It's astounding, these numbers. We can't even fathom it. But as a result of what we're learning about big data, we think that it reflects at least four of the characteristics that we've identified as qualifying for next generation evaluation, and that is shorter cycles, more real-time feedback using alternative formats, newer, innovative, often digital data collection methods, the use of sophisticated data visualization and infographics, and everyone collecting and using data as part of ongoing practice. Let me go back here for a second. So that kind of summarizes the three trends and six characteristics that we believe call for the conversations around what the next generation evaluation might include and what evaluation practice in the social sector might want to pay attention to. But before we ask you to reflect on your experiences and thoughts about these different approaches, we wanted just to share a little bit more information about who's in the room today and what your experiences with these approaches have been. So Eric gave you a little bit of a preview. So these are the six sectors, if you will, or segments on which you're working. 2% of you are coming from corporations. We need to up that. We want more people from corporations to learn about evaluation. Universities, 9%. 14% from government. Consultants, 22%. Nonprofits, 25%. And funders, 28%. And we were actually excited by seeing the diversity of folks in the room, because I think that's going to just enrich our conversations even more. Now, in terms of your experience, we asked you on your registration form what your experience was with these different approaches. 28% of you said you have some experience with developmental evaluation. 29% of you said you have some experience with shared measurement. And 13% have some experience with big data. So now we want to give you a few minutes to chat amongst yourselves around two questions that we'd like you to discuss with either if you have a small table, that's fine, or if you want to break your table or divide your table into two groups, that's fine, of course, as well. And these two questions are, in what ways have you seen the six characteristics show up in your own work? And so we've reminded you of what these are here. I'm not going to read them again. And then what is one question you hope to have answered today through your time with us? So we're going to give you about, how are we on time? About 10 minutes to really think through those conversations and based on what you've heard and what you're looking for from today and what your experiences have been. So go ahead back into your conversations for a few minutes, about 10 minutes. One of the things we love about having a conference like this is the opportunity it gives you all to connect with others. And already we can feel the energy in the room. Are you inspired yet by each other? So we have just a few minutes, and we'd love to hear perhaps from three of you. We have roving mic people. Raise your hand, mic people. And, oh, you know, before we do that, I've been asked, I think everyone is seated now, but if you have an empty seat next to you, would just raise your hand in case someone's looking for a chair? All right, there are a lot of open chairs. Thank you. Make sure you get comfy. So we have the three mic people, and they're going to come over to you, so you don't have to move. And we would love to hear three responses or so from the first question. In what ways have you seen one or more of these characteristics show up in your work? Any volunteers? And then a 30-second response or so. Raise your hand, and one of the mic people will come over to you.
Well, one of the things that our table identified is that even in instances where there's a lot of data being generated, whether it's the nonprofit client or the foundations or the recipients of the data, whomever they are, don't know how to apply it. So there's a bit of paralysis about what to do with the data once it's been collected and presented.
Okay, thank you. Boy, I could talk for 3 days on that topic. It's a very, very important one. Evaluation use is critical. It is what it's all about. Don't ever collect data unless you have a clear intention to use it. That's thought for the day. Okay, over here, yes.
In Monterey County, we are implementing health in all policies, which is a new initiative of ours to work better with our community partners, but also to work with non-traditional partners like community planners, the hospitals, the schools, and looking in long-term pictures and trying to determine how the built environment can contribute to health and human services and improving health and human services.
Okay, thank you. Great. Back here. Thank you.
I guess Monterey County is well represented. We are working on gang violence prevention in Monterey County, and one of our challenges is making sure that the shared data that we're collecting or we're planning to collect is directly communicated to the beneficiaries as mm-hmm. well. This is a discussion here at our table. Mm-hmm. How do we make sure that the beneficiaries of the program actually get something out of the data that's being collected of
yeah.
them?
That's a great issue, and I think that's been an issue that many of us have left behind, is that we collect from people often, and we never help those who provided data understand what we've learned, and then what sense it makes for them as well. Yeah, thank you. I think we have actually time for another one or two. Back here? Yes, okay, meanwhile, one over here.
One of the parts that I found interesting about our discussion was we were talking about focusing on the whole system and sharing responsibility for data collection, and we started talking about that there was, you know, that frequently an infrastructure for doing that was excluded, and you know, we work in a lot of different fields at this table, which is a great part of this conference, and I work in healthcare, and in healthcare and education and other places, there are actually structural impediments to doing those kinds of things.
And maybe today we'll get some ideas on how to overcome or navigate around those impediments and turn those into assets. Okay, thanks. One more, perhaps, back here.
Sure. Yes. Thank you. I come from the world of public health and evaluation as well, and so that's one of our core functions in public health. And so for us, it's letting go of the formal birth certificate data and integrating things, which would you consider maybe an apple, and then integrating some of the big data elements, which maybe are oranges, and creating sort of a smoothie. So what is it that all of our partners at the table can contribute to that? You know, what are their ingredients? And how do we say, track this, and how do we measure progress where everyone feels they have some skin in the game, that they're contributing?
Great, wonderful, thank you. Well, thank you all. I think you'll be able to continue many of these conversations through the breaks and through the lunch and through the conversations that we have in the case studies in the Q&A coming up as well. In conclusion, I want to say something about why we chose the title Next Generation Evaluation for this conference and for our writings. We deliberated quite a while over a long list of titles, and that's an understatement. And it wasn't without a certain level of anxiety, at least at a personal level, that we landed on Next Generation Evaluation. The concern was, of course, that it might sound cliche, or that we were trying too hard to be cool, or that we would just be seen as avid Star Trek fans. But, you know, really, as we reflected on this, on the title and planned this conference and wrote the learning brief that preceded it, we became rather fond of this title. And that's because of what Next Generation really means. So we learned that our next generation tools are about shifting paradigms, changing the ways we think about and understand the world. Next generation solutions have to incorporate legacy features. So remember that not just, but also. They give folks a feeling of security when you're building on the past, and that they reflect the both and of past and future practice. And next generation solutions take legacy features and combine them with new ways of thinking about the problem they're built to solve. So they are able to take the best of the past to create a better future. And in the end, isn't that what we're really all about? So today we are an experiment, we are a learning laboratory, it is a place for conversation. And the last thing I want to say is we didn't create this conference to give answers to anything, but really to promote question asking the why, thinking about why are we curious about this, why are we excited, and to learn from each other. And we hope that we will enjoy the conference and experience really those stimulating, provocative, and insightful conversations today and take something away that will help you do better practice and better thinking tomorrow. So that concludes my part. I now have the distinct pleasure of introducing Sri Gopalakrishnan, who is a director in FSG's Learning and Evaluation Practice and is based in our San Francisco office. Sri has been the thought leader and architect of this conference and the learning brief we published a couple of months ago. Without his leadership on this effort, I'm not really sure we'd all be here today. So thank you, Sri. And please come up here and join us.